Command every cancer cell to dry up tonight in the name of Jesus. God, we speak to heart trouble tonight. We command every heart to be regulated tonight in the name of Jesus. God, we command high blood pressure to be normal tonight in Jesus' name. God, we speak to mental illness tonight, God. God, we declare it gone tonight in Jesus' name. We speak to the mental ill patient tonight, and we declare that you're healed tonight in the name of Jesus. God, heal tonight. God, deliver tonight. God, set free tonight. In the name of Jesus. God, comfort the hearts of those who have lost loved ones, God, who are feeling all alone, who are feeling forgotten. God, comfort them tonight in the name of Jesus. Heal tonight. Deliver tonight. Set free tonight, God. For your word said that by your stripes we were healed. And so tonight, God, we declare our healing. We declare tonight, God, that we are free. We're no longer bound. No more chains are holding us, God. Why? Because you have set us free. So tonight, God, we give you praise. God, we give you glory. God, we give you honor. In Jesus' name, let every heart say amen. Somebody give the Lord praise. Somebody give the Lord glory. Somebody bless his name tonight. Those of you who are watching via YouTube, Facebook, give the Lord praise tonight. Hallelujah. Give him praise tonight. Give the Lord glory. Give him glory tonight. God, we declare your presence in this place. God, we declare your glory in this place tonight. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. God, have your way tonight. Have your way tonight. In this room, praise him. In this room, give him glory. In your home, give him glory. On your job, give him glory. Come on, somebody shout with a voice of triumph. Come on, somebody give him praise. David said, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. I don't care what you're going through tonight. Give him praise. Give him glory. I need you to praise your way through tonight. I need you to praise him until you get a breakthrough. Praise him until healing shows up. Praise him until your deliverance shows up. Give him praise tonight. Give the Lord praise. God, on this Wednesday night, God, we bless your name. We honor you, oh God. We praise you, oh God. We exalt you, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. Hallelujah, God. God, you're awesome. God, you're magnificent. You're wonderful. And for that, God, we give you praise. We give you glory. And God, we give you the honor. God, we thank you tonight. We bless your name tonight. God, we honor you, we praise you, for you are God, and besides you, there is no other. God, you are the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end. God, you are the first and the last. God, everything starts and ends with you. So tonight, God, we praise you. So tonight, God, we bless your name. Come on, everybody, give him a hand clap of praise tonight. Come on, bless his name. Come on, place in the chat, give him praise, hallelujah. Glory to God, hallelujah. We welcome all of you here tonight. Amen, for our midweek service. We bless God, glory to God for you're pressing. You're pressing your way out, amen, to be in the house of God. Those of you who have joined us via live stream, we give God praise and glory for you as well. Glory to God. We need you tonight to share and light. Glory to God. Let folk know that we are live tonight and we are getting ready to dive into the Word of God. Tonight, I want to talk to you from a very basic subject. You may be seated. Glory to God. We're not going to be deep tonight, but it's going to be very basic and direct. Tonight, we want to talk from a subject of distractions. Distractions. Somebody said distractions. Many are called, but few are chosen. The definition of distraction is a thing that prevents someone from giving full attention to something else. Many are called, but few are chosen. Let's look at God's word. We want to look at Nehemiah tonight, Nehemiah chapter 6. Nehemiah chapter 6, media department. We're going to begin our reading at verse number 1. Glory to God. Nehemiah chapter 6. We're going to begin reading at verse number 1. And we're talking tonight again about distractions. How many of you feel you have a calling on your life? You feel that you have a call. You've been called by God for a particular assignment in this earthly realm. By show of hands, Facebook, you're watching, just by show of hands, you feel that you have a call of God on your life. How many of you feel that sometimes you've been distracted? At times in life, you've been distracted. You've kind of swayed away from what God has called you to do. You swayed away from your assignment, from the assignment of God that is on your life. Maybe you were chasing dreams. You was trying to fulfill other assignments, other obligations, and you got sidetracked and you got hoodwinked, so to speak, and you went away from what God had called you to do. And we experience distractions in life, maybe in our families, in our marriages, in our business, our careers. We experience distractions throughout our lives. But we must understand that a distraction is simply something that pulls our attention from our primary purpose. You know, we talk about, you know, being in the house of God, fulfilling the call of God that is on our life. But how many of us know that sometimes we find everything to do other than what God has called us to do? We seek things to do that distracts us from fulfilling the purpose and calling of God on our lives. And then when things begin to fall to pieces in our life, then we come crying back to God, saying, God, save me. We come walking back to God as if God doesn't know that we walked away from him, carrying out our own purpose in the earthly realm. So let's look at Nehemiah chapter 6, beginning at verse number 1. Now it happened when Sanballat, Tobiah, Geshem, the Arab, and the rest of our enemies heard that I had rebuilt the wall and that there were no breaks left in it, though at the time I had not hung the doors in the gates. Now here's Nehemiah. Nehemiah's writing because he's writing and he's stating that his purpose was to build the wall of Jerusalem. But there are some enemies. He talks about his enemies who has come to distract him. The Bible states that the thief cometh but to steal, kill, and destroy. And so Nehemiah tonight talks about how Sanballat and Tobiah and Geshem, the Arabian, how they came to distract him. The enemy will show up when you're doing your best kingdom work. Because the enemy wants to pull you away. The enemy wants to do everything he can do to get you outside the will of God. The Bible said, what profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? And then he said, and the rest of our enemies. You need to identify the enemies of your purpose. There are enemies of your purpose. There are enemies of your assignment. And the only way that you're going to defeat them is by identifying them. And so Nehemiah said, and the rest of our enemies, he had already identified that Sanballat, Tobiah, and Geshem, the Arabian, was his enemies. But he didn't stop there. See, sometimes we point out the enemies that are most recognizable. But Nehemiah said, and the rest of our enemies, the rest of those who are opponents of our assignment. And again tonight, we need to understand that when we say yes to the will of God, we create our enemies are created as our opponents to prevent us from doing what God has called us to do. He said, heard that I had built a wall and that there was no breach left therein, though at the time I had not set up the doors upon it, which simply lets us know that there were still openings in the wall. See, sometimes when you're doing a great work, when you're carrying out the assignment of God that is on your life, it looks bigger to your enemy than it does you. Sometimes we can't see the importance of what we're doing. Sometimes we can't see the effect of what we're doing is having on others. We can't see it because we're involved. Nehemiah said the gates were not put up yet. There were still openings in the wall. The job was not completed. The enemy does not want you to complete your assignment. So before the doors are placed up, before the gates are hung, the enemy is going to do everything he can do to get you out of the will of God. Tell somebody distractions. You got to be aware of distractions. You got to know tonight that distractions are not your friends. They are designed to kill you. They are designed to take you outside the will of God. They are designed to pull you away from your assignment. And so Nehemiah recognized his enemies. He recognized his opponents. That Sanballat and Geshem sent to me saying, come, let us meet together among the villages in the plain of Ono. He said, look, they're calling Nehemiah away from his assignment. It is like you've been called by God, you've been assigned by God, and everybody find a reason why you should leave your work and come to them. Now, if they were so much for Nehemiah, why didn't they go where he was? The enemy wants to get you away from what God has called you to do so that he can destroy your life, so that he can take you out. If he gets you away from your protection, then he got you. But I need somebody to declare tonight that no weapon that is formed against me shall prosper. Declare it into the atmosphere. No weapon that is formed against me shall prosper. But they thought to do me harm. Nehemiah had a spirit of discernment, which so many believers lack today. We lack discernment in so many areas of our lives. We fall for the okey-doke. We fall for the tricks of the enemy. The enemy comes and so often we say yes to the enemy. Not that we love the enemy more than God, but sometimes the enemy makes things so attractive to us that we sometimes think that it's God. Who has fallen for the enemy's tricks before? We fall for the enemy's tricks to find out that the enemy was just leading us away from the plan of God for our lives. And so we get sidetracked. And then we find ourselves walking back to God after we've been tricked by the enemy. Distraction. You got to get to a place that you can discern distractions. And so Nehemiah said, they meant to do me harm. They were trying to get me into a place to attack me, to destroy me. You know, it's like when you're around your brothers and sisters in the Lord, you have great power, you have great strength, you have great courage. So the enemy will sometimes in life try to isolate you. Again, try to get you by yourself so that he can take you out. How many of you know that you can fight better when you got some folk fighting with you? When you got some folk fighting with you, you can fight a little bit longer. You know, it's like when you was in school, when somebody was trying to jump you, you may have been a little afraid when you were by yourself. But when you got a crowd around you, some kind of way boldness just showed up out of nowhere. So now I'm going to say you the bad boy. Now I'm going to say you the bad girl. Because now you got some help. And so the enemy will make you think that you're strong enough to be by yourself. That you're strong enough to isolate yourself from the people and things of God. But tonight you got to operate in a spirit of discernment. Somebody said discernment. You must understand that the enemy is not your friend. So when the enemy starts proposing to you or saying, come here, come do this, let's go here, let's hang out here, the enemy is trying to set you up for your fall, for your destruction. So I sent messengers to them saying, I am doing a great work. In order for you to fulfill your purpose, your assignment, the call of God on your life, you must recognize the importance of your assignment. Sometimes we look at our assignment as if it's not that much, as if it's something little. Oh, you know, I'm just an usher at the church. I don't do much. Ushering is a great responsibility. Well, you know, I'm on the maintenance team at the church, and I make sure everything. I'm not that important. You are very important. And so Nehemiah understood the importance or the value of his assignment. And so many of us really don't understand the value of our assignment. When you understand the value of your assignment, you're not so easily removed from your place of purpose. So many of us get out of place because we don't recognize the value of our assignment. You being in place makes a world of difference. Folks know when you're out of place. Folks know when you miss your assignment. Because only you can carry out your assignment. Only you can fulfill the assignment of God that is on your life. It's like you stay off from work. And because you are the only person working on the job, when you show back up to work, everybody says, wow, we sure miss you. What they were saying that we really don't work when you're here. But you were out yesterday, we really had to work. So you got to get to a place as Nehemiah did. You got to get to a place that you understand the value of your assignment. Your assignment is valuable to the kingdom of God. And I know you're saying, well, pastor, I'm not all that. I don't do this. I don't do that. I'm not the pastor. I'm not the deacon. I'm not this. I'm not that. But you're valuable in God's eyes. Your assignment is valuable. You are valuable. Tell somebody I'm valuable. And so Nehemiah said, I'm too valuable to leave my assignment. You know, the Bible talks about the man that said, let me go back and bury my father. And Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. In other words, what Jesus was really saying to the man was, you have purpose here. So let those who have no purpose take care of purposeless things. And I know we can't grasp that because it's impossible to believe that Jesus would not allow the man to go back and bury his father. Jesus said, no, you got purpose here. I need you to be in place. I need you to be in position. I need you to understand that your assignment has value. So Nehemiah said, I sent messengers to them saying, I am doing a great work so that I cannot come down. Then he said, why should the work cease while I leave it and go down to you? So what Nehemiah was really saying, you're insignificant. And you got to get to a place as believers, as children of God, that you identify insignificant people, insignificant things, insignificant places in your life. You got to identify those things. Tell somebody they're insignificant. And so when they're insignificant, you understand the purpose and calling of God that is on your life. This is not for the regular believer, But this is for the kingdom first thinker. See, when you're kingdom first, as Nehemiah was, you understand again the importance of your assignment. You understand that if you're not doing your assignment, it can't be done. And I know some folks that you're doing too much, you're overboard, or you're trying to be too deep. No, I understand what God has called me to do. So that's why if I'm across the world Sunday morning, I'm trying to be back in place. I'm trying to be where I'm supposed to be because this is where God has called me. And if this is where God has called me, I got to give reverence to the assignment of God that is on my life. If you're the greeter, you're the first person that people see when they enter the church. If you're the minister, you're the voice of representation. And so what people see when they come into the church, what they hear while they're sitting in the church, are supposed to impact their lives or will impact their lives. And so you got to make sure that you value your assignment. And so tonight we're talking about distraction because we can very easily be distracted. Well, pastor, I got to go and bury my father. I got a business I got to run. I got this I got to do. I got that I got to do. We always got excuses of what we got to do when it comes down to the things of God. Well, I wasn't there last night because, you know, I had this going on. I had that going on. Have you ever thought about prioritizing your schedule? And saying that, you know what, some things just has priority over others. It's like you're saying you've been at home all day and 6:30 come and you start cooking dinner. You start cooking dinner because you had no concern or no thought really about coming to church. And so the next time you see someone in church, you say, I was coming Wednesday night, but you know, I had to cook dinner. But you was at home all day. So when things are valuable to you or has value to you, you will be where you're supposed to be when you're supposed to be there. You'll do what you're supposed to do when you're supposed to do it. Why? Because it has value to you. There was a time in society when everything was planned around Wednesday night Bible study. I mean, you know, nothing really happened on Wednesday night because they knew that church would have service on Wednesday night. And now society don't care. They plan Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And you get caught up in all of those days. And you neglect the things of God until all hell began to break loose in your life. And then when all hell break loose in your life, you come running to the church. Lord, help me. Lord, save me. Lord, deliver me. I need somebody to pray for me. And that is fine. But you must understand your value to the kingdom. You must understand that you have a kingdom assignment. And your kingdom assignment should have priority over everything else. And as I sent messengers unto them saying, I am doing a great work so that I cannot come down. Why should the work cease while I leave it and come down to you? And if we're going to have any success in our lives, in our ministry, in our relationships, we're going to have to understand what's valuable and what's not valuable to us. And watch this. You cannot judge or determine what's valuable to you based on somebody else's opinion. Because everybody has an opinion. It's all about your value. It's all about what's valuable to you. How are you going to live your life? What set of values do you live your life by? And so people try to intrude on your purpose, on your calling, on your assignment with their values by saying, you know, it really don't take all of that. You just at church Sunday. Why you got to be back at church Wednesday? And you're saying, because I have an assignment. I have purpose. I need to be in position. I have to be in place. And because God has a holy calling on my life, I desire development to fulfill the calling of God that is on my life. He said, why should the work stop while I come down and hang out with you? You having a barbecue. and you want me to hang out with you on the barbecue. You really don't value my assignment, because you plan the barbecue right when you know that I'm supposed to be at church, right when you know that I have street ministry, right when you know that I have to go out and feed the homeless. You already know that I have an assignment. You knew this. You know I do this every Wednesday. And so watch this, beloved. The enemy will use those who are closest to you. And you'll fall for it because you're saying, you know what? This is my baby. This is my auntie. This is my mother. This is such and such. And you'll fall for it because you value them over your assignment. If you're not kingdom first thinkers, you will not get this tonight. You would think that I'm talking crazy. But Nehemiah said, why should the work stop while I come out and hang out with you? Nehemiah considered them insignificant. And then think twice about it. How many of you have told somebody no and you felt guilty about telling them no? How many of you have been there before? Somebody invited you somewhere and you didn't show, and you kind of regret seeing them the next day because you know they invited you and they wanted you to be there, but you kind of felt some kind of way. You got to get to a place that you're comfortable with saying no. You got to get to a place that you're comfortable with saying, you know what? I can't make that event. I got more important things to do. You may not tell them that direct, but you let them know that you have something more valuable to do. And so in life, as believers, as children of God, we got to get comfortable with saying no. It's like somebody walk up to you and say, you know what? I need $100. But you know that you need $500. Or you have $500 to take care of business. And you know if you give them $100, they're going to put you $100 short. And so you give them the $100 rather than telling them no, because you didn't want to hurt their little feelings. Oh, here you go. I'll find another 100 somewhere. No. You let them go through their trial, and you handle what you need to handle. And I know somebody said, well, Pastor, you're teaching people not. No, I'm not teaching them that at all. I'm teaching us to be comfortable with saying no. Sometimes you got to get to a place that you just say no. See, church folk have been tricked to believe that we can't say no, that it's not godly to say no, that we always got to say yes, that we always got to be in a place of giving and not receiving. We've been tricked. And as long as you live your life surrounded by saying yes, you will never get to where God is trying to take you. You will never fulfill the assignment of God that is on your life. And so Nehemiah said, no. Somebody said no. I mean, just really get indignant with your no. Just say no. And you got to get to a place you say no and you mean your no. And you know, sometimes we really don't mean our no. No. But you got to get to a place that no. And they say, you really mean that? Yes, I really mean no. And the answer is no. And walk away and not feel guilty. Feel good about saying no. And I know, again, I know, you know, everybody around the world is saying, you know what? That is not Christian. Why is it not? In what book is it not Christian? Jesus said no on many occasions. Jesus had to let people know when he meant no. The disciples said, you know what? Send the folks away. We don't have enough food to feed them. Jesus said, no, sit them down. And where are we going to get all this food from to feed all these folks? You don't see this crowd? Jesus, sit them down. Give me the 2 fish and 5 loaves. And Jesus lifted and fed a multitude of 5,000. What Jesus had to understand, what Jesus understood better than we, is that no was in order. See, sometimes no is in order. And you get to a place that you feel like you got to say yes all the time, you are setting yourself up. And you're setting yourself up for destruction. Had Nehemiah left his place of assignment, the wall would have never been finished. Why? Because they weren't meeting for a friendly meeting. They was meeting to take Nehemiah out, to do Nehemiah mischief. They had no good interest for Nehemiah. So Nehemiah had to discern that the enemy, the thief, cometh only but to steal, kill, and destroy. If they can just get me away from this wall, they're going to kill me. If the enemy can get you outside your assignment, he's going to kill you. But I need somebody to declare in this place that I should live and not die. And so the enemy is trying to lure you away from your assignment. And watch this. Sometimes he'll give a business to you to get you outside the will of God. And so now you're focusing more on the business than you are on your God-given purpose. And God said, look, tonight I need to get you back to focusing on your purpose, on your calling, on your assignment. How many of you have an assignment from God? How many of you fulfilling your assignment from God? God said, look, I need you to refocus. Somebody said, refocus. I need you to refocus and focus your attention solely on me. Sometimes we get to a place in life, we try to do too many things at once. Who in here can multitask? And I know it, everybody said men cannot multitask. Men can only do one thing at a time. You give them multiple things to do at once, they're going to mess up. It's like chewing bubble gum and walking at the same time. Men can't do that. They'll trip over their own feet. And so God said, you're not capable of multitasking, so I need you to focus. I need you to put all of your attention on your purpose and on your calling. Fulfill your assignment in this earthly realm. Nehemiah returned to Jerusalem to rebuild the Jerusalem wall. And the enemy came and tried to distract him from doing what God had called him to do. You got to have the, you must exercise the ability to judge well. You got to judge some things. Your judgment is vital. Your ability to judge what's important or what's valuable to you and what's not valuable to you is important. So you get to a place of understanding that, you know, this is my main focus. My main focus is doing the will of God, is pleasing God. No matter what I lose over here, my main focus is over here, pleasing God. Remember the Bible said, what profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? See, the enemy will lure you away from the purpose of God or from your purpose with attractive things. That's why we got to get to a place that we don't serve God simply for things. That we serve God because of who he is. Because he is the Alpha. He is the Omega. He is the beginning. He is the end. So we serve God because he is the creator of the universe. And so with that in mind, he is more valuable to us than anything else. But they sent me this message four times. And I answered them in the same manner. It's like someone asks you something. They ask you once. You say no. They ask you twice. You say no. They ask you a third time. You say no. But then the fourth time they ask you, you say, come on and get it. I'm tired of you bothering me. I'm tired of you bugging me. No, you got to get to a place that even the fourth time, your answer is still no. And you got to let them know. I don't care how many times you asked me, my answer is still no. And you got to stand your ground with your no. There are too many of us giving in to the enemy. The enemy sent the same message to Nehemiah four times. You would think one no would be enough. But they didn't think Nehemiah was serious about his purpose. They didn't think Nehemiah was serious about his calling. So they kept asking him, man, look, we're having lunch over here. Join us for lunch. And Nehemiah said, no. I'm not eating your burnt cornbread today. Nehemiah said, no, I'm not hanging out with you. I have an assignment to do. And again, we must understand that the enemy will always send distractions our way. He will always send those who are close to us to distract us or to cause us to lose focus on what God has called us to do. So Nehemiah said, no. No, I'm not coming. He said, and I answered them in the same manner. Then Sanballat sent his servant to me as before the fifth time with an open letter in his hand. Now they really, really wanted to get Nehemiah out of place. And you must understand tonight that your purpose and calling is very valuable to the kingdom of God. So the enemy would do anything he can or anything she can to get you outside the will of God. And you say, oh no, not little me. You know, I didn't finish high school. I didn't finish college. You know, I don't know how to enunciate my words. I'm this, I'm that. You find every reason in the book to devalue your calling, to devalue your purpose. And you're saying, well, no, not me. Surely gotta be somebody else. And God said, no, I called you. I anointed you. And you're trying to give your anointing away to somebody else. But you got to understand that God anointed you for this season. Then Sanballat sent his servant to me as before, the fifth time, with an open letter in his hand. Watch this. In it was written, it was reported among the nations. And Geshem says that you and the Jews plan to rebel. Therefore, according to these rumors, you are rebuilding the wall. See, watch this. Rumors. You remember the song that said rumors? Haters will spread rumors each and every day. They spread rumors because they want to discourage you from fulfilling your assignment. See, if the enemy can get you out of place, he has won. If you would listen to rumors and allow rumors to sway you to move outside the purpose of God for your life, the enemy knows that he will win. And so they come to Nehemiah with rumors. Nothing factual about what they're saying. They're talking about something that has been rumored. Something that has been made up. It's like a mess deck rumor. When we was in the Navy, we called them mess deck rumors. You know, you're at sea and somebody spread the rumor that you're getting ready to pull in off a six-month cruise 3 months early. And you get your hopes all up because you're saying, man, I heard that it's rumored that we're getting ready to pull in off this six-month cruise 3 months early. You're excited because you didn't want to be out there anyway. And sometimes in the body of Christ, we're excited with rumors because we don't want to be doing what God has called us to do anyway. You got to fall in love with what God has called you to do. Somebody said, Mount Simon. My assignment is my assignment, and there's nothing you can do to cause me to move outside of my assignment. Every month, it's reported that over 18,000 pastors resign from the pulpit. And some of the stuff that we have to deal with, sometimes you can really understand why pastors resign. But I need somebody to know tonight, only the strong will survive. Only those who value their assignment, only those who understand what they've been called to do will stand and be counted among the best. So you got to get to a place that you don't let rumors cause you to leave your assignment. You let allow rumors to cause you to walk away from the pulpit. You don't allow rumors to cause you to miss God. And so they came to Nehemiah with some rumors, talking about some unfactual stuff. And so in the letter, according to these rumors, you are rebuilding the wall that you may rebel or that you may be the king. Isn't it amazing how when God starts blessing your life, when God starts putting you in place to elevate you, how folks get afraid, how folks get nervous and think that you come to take over? And you really didn't come to take over. You're just walking in your assignment. You're just walking in your purpose. You're just walking in your calling. But everybody around you get nervous because they feel like you're getting ready to be the big kid on the block. And which you are, because you are driven by your purpose. You are driven by the call of God that is on your life. So everybody's shaking. They said, we heard that you're getting ready to make yourself king. We heard that you're getting ready to promote yourself. And Nehemiah hadn't said such thing. And so if you're not careful, you will allow rumors to cause you to move outside the will of God. Why? Because we don't like folk talking about us. How many of you get bothered when you hear folks and talked about you or said something negative about you? How many of you get bothered? Now, we're going to do the repentance prayer after we get done. Because I know all of y'all lying. That's right. They don't bother me, Pastor. Yeah, yes, they do. It may not bother you like it used to bother you, but it bothers you. Because we hate when folk lie on us. You know, we get mad when folk tell the truth on us, but we hate them when they lie on us. And so they have rumored that Nehemiah is getting ready to make himself king. But Nehemiah never fathomed in his mind that he was going to become king. All Nehemiah wanted to do was restore Jerusalem. All Nehemiah understood was that he had an assignment on his life. Nehemiah understood that he must be in place to fulfill his God-given purpose. And so now all of a sudden they come up and they say, you know what, let's send him a letter. We can't get him to leave. Well, let's take the information to him. Because the enemy knows that if he can get some negative seeds planted, that you're going to walk away. That you're going to cease from doing the work of God. All the enemy wants to do is plant some negative seeds. And so rather than Nehemiah meeting them, they send a letter with negativity. They send a letter with a false report. And so written in this letter, they said, you know what? The Jews think to rebel for which cause thou builded the wall that thou mayest be their king. According to these what? Words. It's according to these words. So now all of a sudden, in front of Nehemiah is a letter filled with lies, filled with rumors. Because everybody around him is now nervous because of his assignment. And watch this. And you have appointed prophets to proclaim concerning you at Jerusalem, saying, there is a king in Judah. Now these matters will be reported to the king. So come, therefore, and let us consult together. So now the enemy is really hoping that Nehemiah becomes afraid. Then Nehemiah said, you know what? Okay, I'm going with you. The enemy, again, will trick you. He will lie to you to move you outside the will and purpose of God on your life. Why? Because he understands that if you're in place, folk will get saved. He understands that if you're in place, folk will get delivered. Folk will get sanctified. Folk will be filled with the Holy Ghost. Why? Because you're in your assigned place. And the enemy knows that if you stay in place, that his time is limited. The enemy knows that if you're doing your work, that as you work for God, that you're snatching folks out of the kingdom of darkness. And they're joining hands with God. So the enemy said, what can I do to stop him? What can I do to stop her? What can I do to discourage them? What can I say to cause them to doubt that they've been called by God? So the enemy is sending out a spirit of discouragement, wanting you to walk away from your assignment, wanting you to walk away from your calling. But tell somebody, I will stand until the end of it. I will stand, I will stand. I'm not leaving my post. I understand what I've been called to do. I understand the assignment of God that is on my life. So I got to stand. I got to stay put. I got to sit right here until breakthrough shows up. I will sit here until my change has come. And so Nehemiah building the wall. He continues to build and not be distracted. And tonight, I don't know who I'm talking to. Maybe you're here tonight. Maybe you're watching via Facebook or YouTube. But I need somebody to be encouraged tonight. You got to build until the job is finished. When God releases you, then you're released, but not until he releases you. I don't care how dim it began to look. You need to know that you're on an assignment from God. How do you know that you're on an assignment from God? You know that you're on an assignment from God based on the attacks of the enemy against your calling. I mean, sometimes pray, devil, leave me alone. You really want the devil to leave you alone? When the devil stops bothering you, it's going to be at the end of your life, at the end of your purpose. So sometimes, you know, I know we don't like to fight the devil, and sometimes we get tired, and sometimes we just want to break in life, and we just want the devil to leave us alone. But you know, if you be honest with yourself, the devil really keep you praying. The devil really keep you believing God. The devil really keep you saying, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, I give you praise. Lord, I give you glory. Lord, I give you all the honor. The devil really keeps you on your knees. And I know you really think that you can make it without the devil. Oh, I can praise God without the devil. Can you really? It's not can you really, will you really? Will you give him praise when there's no adversity in your life? Will you give him praise when there's no trouble in your life? Will you bless his name when everything is going well in your life? We praise God at our best when the devil is on our tracks. See, the thing that we must understand, not that the devil must cease, but we must resist the devil. See, when you resist the devil, the Bible said the devil will flee from you. That means the devil would only come so close to you. He can only get so close to you because your hallelujah is a devil. You got to stop right here. Sickness, you got to stop right here. Disease, you got to stop right here. Poverty, you got to stop right here because of my praise, because of my worship unto God. See, when you give God praise, when you give God glory, the enemy can only get so close. Purpose. Your assignment, and I'm going to mess some of you up tonight because we pray to God to deliver us every time we face adversity. I think it was Paul that said he went to God three times and asked God to remove the thorn from his flesh. And after God resoundingly said no, Paul then stated, his grace is sufficient. Now, what are you saying tonight, Pastor? Sometimes what you go through in life is a testimony to others that God is God. And what are you saying, Pastor? What are you saying? Sometimes when we go through in life, it is a testimony that God is God, simply because if it had been anybody else, they would have been dead a long time ago. But the fact that you're still standing, the fact that you're still giving God praise, the fact that you're still giving him glory is evident that there is a God. And we're saying, well, God, can you remove this? God said, no, I'm showing forth my glory in the earth through your afflictions. And you're saying, well, God, really? I really got to go through this? And I know it don't make sense, because we pray to God to heal us, to deliver us of everything. But sometimes God will let the thorn stay there to prove to others that he is God. And tonight, I don't know who I'm talking to. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what you're up against. But you need to know tonight that what you're going through is not going to kill you, but it's going to bring glory to the name of the Lord. And you're trying to get out of giving glory to God. And God said, no, I got to take you through this. It's like you broke, busted, and disgusted, but you don't want to be broke, busted, and disgusted. And God said, I got to let you be broke, busted, and disgusted in this season, so when I bless you in your next season, everybody will know that I did it for you. And you're trying to escape. You're trying to get out of this season, and God is prolonging the time. Anybody ever ask God, God, why are you taking so long? It's because God doesn't operate in time. In the spirit realm, it's already done. God is waiting for your faith to catch up to the spirit realm. God is waiting for you to catch up in the spirit realm to realize that by his stripes you were healed, which simply means that God healed you over 2,000 years ago. And you're saying, God, why are you taking so long? I've been going through this thing for the last 3 years. And God said, you only been dealing with it for a fraction of a second. And you're saying, God, no, I've been watching my calendar for the last 3 years. And I can tell you, I've been dealing with this for the last 3 years. God said, I'm not a God of time.
And you're trying to figure out, why is God prolonging the time? And God said, I'm developing you. I'm molding you. I'm shaping you. And you're saying, no, I don't want to be molded. I don't want to be shaped. But you say yes to the will of God. You say yes to the will of God. You say yes to his way. You say, God, whatever you need to do in my life, do it. And all of a sudden, things start to go crazy in your life according to the flesh. And then you say, God, you've forgotten about me. God, I really don't want to call, and I really don't want to do what you told me to do, God, because I really don't feel like going through this. Can anybody endure the night season? The night season is but a moment. And watch this. When God shows up, when God blesses your life, everything that happened in your night season will be forgotten about. All the trials, all the tribulations will be forgotten about. You'll be giving God glory. You'll be blessing his name. Why? Because you understand that God has opened the windows of heaven and poured you out a blessing. You have room not enough to receive. Somebody receive it tonight. Somebody receive your healing tonight. Somebody receive your deliverance tonight. We're too busy fighting the purpose of God on our life. Paul had to deal with the thorn that was in his flesh. The woman with the issue of blood, she had to deal with it for 12 years. The man that was sitting at the pool of Bethesda for 38 long years had to deal with his situation until Jesus showed up. And I need somebody to know tonight, the old folk used to say that he may not come when you want him, but he's always on time. That's how they used to preach back in Alabama. But I need somebody to know tonight that God is not a God that operates in time. God is waiting for you to catch up with what he's already done. So in the hospital room with tubes running down your throat, you need to give God praise and thank him for your healing. When the doctor give you a diagnosis of cancer, you need to praise God and thank him for his healing. Why? Because it's already done. Somebody said, it's already done. He's already healed me. He's already delivered me. He's already set me free. That's why I give him praise before manifestation. I don't have to see manifestation to know that God has already done it. And I know somebody tonight will talk, well, Pastor, I understand what you're saying, but I feel nothing what you're saying. It's because you don't understand what it means to walk by faith and not by sight. I need somebody to declare in this place, Hebrews 11:1, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things that are not seen. I don't care what it looked like. God is still God. I don't care how broke you are, how busted you are, how disgusted you are. God is still God. Distractions. Distractions are designed to pull you or to lure you outside the will of God. There's a purpose on your life. God wants to use you in this earthly realm to bring glory to his name. But you cannot allow distractions to cause you to walk away from your assignment. And somebody saying, Pastor, I hear you, I understand you, but there are some things I'm just too far in now. You can't worry about what you're going to lose. You can't worry about who's going to walk out of your life. What's important to you is fulfilling the assignment of God that is on your life. Somebody give God praise. Somebody give him glory. Somebody give the Lord honor. Hallelujah. God, we bless you tonight. We honor you tonight, for you are the great I am. So tonight, God, we lift our voices. We lift our hands to you. We lift our heads, our eyes to you. We look to the hills from whence cometh our help. God, knowing that our help comes from you. God, we trust you to be Lord of Lords and King of Kings. We trust you, God, to be the author and finisher of our faith. So tonight, God, we put our trust in you. God, we cry out to you tonight. Heal us, God. Deliver us, set us free in the name of Jesus.
God, we cry out to you. Hosanna, save us tonight, God, in the name of Jesus. God, heal in this place. God, we give you praise. God, we speak to cancer tonight. We command cancer cells to dry up tonight. God, we speak to mental illness tonight. We command it to cease tonight in the name of Jesus. God, we speak to heart trouble. We command hearts to be healed. God, we speak to relationship, marriages tonight, God. We command restoration in the name of Jesus. God, we declare your glory in this place. Release peace in this place, God. Release the joy of our salvation in this place, in the name of Jesus. So God, we give you praise. God, we give you glory. God, we thank you because it's already done. We thank you, God, for giving sight to the blind, for making the lame man walk again. God, we give you praise, God, for your healing power. In Jesus' name, let every heart say amen. Somebody give the Lord praise. Somebody give the Lord glory. Somebody shout in this place. Lord, you're worthy to be praised. Somebody tell the Lord, Lord, you're worthy to be praised. You deserve our worship, God. You deserve our worship, God. God, you deserve our praise. And for this, we give you praise. We give you glory. In Jesus' name, let every heart say amen. Somebody bless his name. Somebody shout with a voice of victory. For he is Lord of Lords. He is King of Kings. He is the Alpha. He is the Omega. He is the beginning and the end. So tonight, God, we give you praise. We give you glory. Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane went back and forth with God, asking for the cup to pass him. And then he finally gave in to the purpose and calling of God on his life and said, Lord, thy will be done. And so somebody tonight need to say, Lord, your will be done. In Jesus' name, somebody give the Lord praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're shifting glory to God. We're preparing for our ministry of giving glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, we bless your name. Lord, we honor you. Lord, we praise you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. There are several ways tonight that you can give. You can give via Givelify or Cash App, $Damascus, INT, or you can log on to our website at www.damascusint.org. Glory to God. Or you can log on to our website at P.O. Box. You can mail your offering in at P.O. Box 2132, Forest Park, Georgia, 30298. Hallelujah. We're so excited. Amen. We encourage you tonight, amen, to give your very best. Glory to God. Honor God with your tithe and with your offering. The Bible states that we are to bring our tithe and our offering into the house of God, that there may be meat in his house. And then God says, prove me. See when I open unto you the windows of heaven. Glory to God. Release your seed tonight. Release your tithe. Release your offering. Glory to God. In an act of obedience unto the word of God. Lift your offering. Lift your devices all over this room. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, we thank you. Lord, we give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor, God, for you are the great I am. God, in obedience to you, we release tonight our tithe, our offering, our seed in Jesus' name. God, increase now, regardless of the amount. Increase, God, in Jesus' name. Let every heart say amen. Somebody bless him. Somebody give him praise. Somebody give the Lord glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're so excited, amen, about what God is doing in this season. We give God all the praise. We give him all the glory. Amen. For your faithfulness to the things of God. We bless God for you coming out tonight and worshiping God in person. Hallelujah. Those of you who join via YouTube, Facebook, we bless God for you. We encourage you tonight to not allow distractions to hinder your purpose and call of God. Get in place. Reposition yourself to fulfill the assignment of God on your life in Jesus' name. Glory to God. We're preparing now to close, to leave this place, but never the presence of God. Glory to God. I want to encourage you tonight to join us at 6 a.m. in the morning for our morning prayer. Glory to God. Join us each and every morning, Monday through Friday, at 6 a.m. for our morning prayer. Glory to God. The information will be on the screen for those of you, amen, who are watching via Facebook. The information is there. YouTube, the information is there. Amen. Log on each and every morning. Let's start our morning with prayer and a word from God. We're so excited again about what it is that God is doing in this season. Have a blessed and awesome night. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, we thank you. We give you praise, glory, and honor. God, as we prepare to leave this place, but never your presence, cover us, protect us under your blood. God, we thank you now in Jesus' name. Let every heart say amen. Somebody give him praise tonight. Somebody give him glory. Hallelujah.